So greetings, 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 divine ones. So welcome back to another connection session, a very special connection session. I have my dear friend Darren here with me. I'm so very pleased and happy and excited that Darren reached out to me. And I was like, let's talk about some things. Let's talk about religion versus spirituality. So if those of you who don't know me, my name is Denise Worrell, also known as Divine. My channel on YouTube is called Divine Fitness Vlog. And I focus on holistic health, meaning mind, body, and spirit, living the alkaline lifestyle, and raising the vibration with pure love energy. So that's who I am. So I'm going to hand it over to Darren. Yeah, let us know who you are and like what you do and stuff like that.
Right. Okay, Brother Darren X here.
Yes.
Artistically known as Free Kid Beans. Mm-hmm. I am a student in the Nation of Islam under the Honorable Brother Minister Louis Farrakhan. My journey has been ever evolving. I've been wanting to put a name to what it is that I do for so long. I've gone through several stages of things, calling, lifestyles, or philosophies. I can run through a list of them. Mm-hmm. But right now, due to some work that I've done with a conscious coach, her name is Celicia Shan. Sister is amazing. I don't know if she knows how much she's helped me, but she's been a good help. Yeah. But it was an exercise that she had me to focus on. Mm-hmm. And maybe we may go through this during our dialogue, but mm-hmm. you know, she was like, you know, find like three things that you like to do. And I mean, you know, it was a struggle, but I kind of weaved it down. So right now, the theme that I'm in now is called the GAP Project.
Okay.
Or GAP. That's the focus. So God, art, psychology.
Ooh, okay. I like that. Yes, ma'am. It's a good combination.
Yes, ma'am. So that's where I'm at.
Yeah. That's where I'm beautiful. At. That's really beautiful. So God, art, and psychology. Wow. Mm-hmm. So that I really connect with that because it's like I say mind, body, spirit. I mean, what is spirit? Like, spirit is everything. And what is God? God is everything. And so it's kind of like, yeah, spirit, art. Art is, wow, it's just an expression of God. It's an expression of source. So it's like, shouts out to, her name's Celicia.
Celicia Shan, yes.
Yeah,
Coach T.
Shouts out to Coach T. I love that. Focus on three things that you love. Wow. Okay.
Mm. And so that's what came together as a result, yeah. Right? So, yeah. Psychology.
Mm-hmm.
Because I have been doing some journaling.
Yeah.
Right. So I'm more active with journaling. I'm more active with writing than mm-hmm. I have been in a long time.
Okay.
So what I recall is I want to say eighth grade.
Mm-hmm.
I was watching Arthur and yes. they were talking about meditation.
Yes.
Right. So I'm like, okay, what is this thing mm-hmm. called? So I go on a computer
mm-hmm.
and I do a little reading on it. Right. And so, you know, you're supposed to like, you know, sense things. You're just supposed to breathe and go in and, yeah. Come aware of your mind. So I did it, and mm-hmm. I was like, "Man, this is this next level."
It is.
Oh, yes, ma'am. So that led me to thinking about thinking more.
Oh, yeah.
And then how man, I want to say just how the mind works, yeah, and all the different mechanisms of the mind. And so psychology, you know, comes out of that. So mm-hmm. it's only recently where I've come back around to really looking at psychology and for more of a, you know, pursuing it more seriously.
Absolutely. Wow. So look at that author being a author, a children's show on PBS, like mm-hmm. being a doorway to, you know, opening up more possibilities and expanding your consciousness just through a simple message on a child show. I love Author. I was literally just watching an episode of Author a couple of days ago. Like, I love Author. That's so beautiful. But yeah, so psychology, I don't know if everyone or anyone out there knows, I studied at Northern Illinois University, nutrition and psychology. So yeah, go Huskies. But yeah, so psychology is really, I feel like the one of those stepping stones towards either religion or spirituality, whatever, you know, daily practice you choose to pursue. That's like a stepping stone for me, at least, because like you said, understanding the workings of the mind and like, why do we do what we do? And what, interestingly enough, what got me interested in psychology was marketing. Mm-hmm. How are these companies able to kind of influence our minds? Because I don't know if everything is connected, right? Like, everything is everything. All is one. There's one love, you know? So it's like taking something like psychology and spirituality or religion and meshing all of those things together. It's like the trifecta, like mind, body, spirit, mind, body, soul, mind, body, you know. Oh, and that's another thing. I know you say you are, I want you to expound a little bit more on, you know, what you do as far as your religious practice and stuff like that. Because I have some basis about the religion and, you know, Louis Farrakhan and stuff like that. But yeah, I want to hear from you. You take it away. I want to hear from you.
Okay. Well, mm-hmm. I wanted to, before I touch that, I wanted to comment on, you said you study in psychology and nutrition together.
Yeah.
And so mind, body, and spirit, mm-hmm. what we eat, what we take in our bodies, because it has a biochemical effect.
Yes.
And that biochemistry, you know, the brain processes everything. So mm-hmm. it's the materials that we give it. So if it's low quality, right, then your brain is working on low quality fuel. If it's mm-hmm. High quality fuel, the lower, the higher.
Right,
real simple. So mm-hmm. I mean, that's a great combination, man. And I really pray you know, you take that and move mountains with it, because Black people are really suffering,
yes.
Because of our diets and our lifestyles that, you know, comes out of slavery.
Yes,
that's a little touch. Okay. But to Islam, so Islam, as we're taught, is mathematics. So Islam is mathematics, and mathematics is Islam.
Okay.
So we're taught that Islam is the nature of God.
Okay.
Right? It is the religion of God. Mm-hmm. And that makes sense, because we see the universe, right? The universe follows laws. It's order. The planet, 93 million miles from the sun, travels 1,037 and a third miles per hour. Rotating on this axis, right? And this gives us the change of the seasons and things like that.
Right.
The distances between the planets. Everything is perfect order, and all in submission to the law of light.
Yes.
Right. So it's if we submit, when we submit to the law.
Yeah.
And that opens up a that opens up opportunity for us to grow into our nature because we're submitting to the law, which is governed by Islam, and become who we really are. We can reflect God by submitting to the laws that God has arranged to us with.
That's beautiful.
These are those the teachings, right? So,
okay.
As for myself, Islam came as a result of, you know, me being a seeker. I left the church 8 years ago and 8 or 10 years ago, it was around that time. And because I was having a very difficult time with Christianity.
Yeah.
What it meant. I had a difficult time with what was being espoused from the rostrum, the history of it. So I decided to leave, and I had a one-on-one with God, because me and God we've had some interesting experiences.
Yes.
I'll share this one. I'll share this one, first time I've ever shared this publicly, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay.
When I was in Florida in high school, I was on a family reunion, and I was struggling with my faith back then, going to church. Something happened with the leadership, and it caused the church to stop meeting for a while, a couple of months. So I wasn't going to church. And so, you know, I'm thinking like, you know, man of God, woman of God, where's just the vibe? You know, because it was with the leadership. I had a conversation. So we in a family reunion with my summer vacation or whatnot. And I went to, I was on the fourth floor, right, of the hotel. It was only six floors. It was on the fourth floor.
Okay.
I went to the balcony and, no, excuse me. I went to the sixth floor.
Okay.
I went to the very top. I went to the sixth floor. I went on a balcony and I'm looking up at the stars. It's beautiful. And I'm talking to the God. I'm like, look, man, I need you to show me you real, because I'm not vibing with this whole, like, I mean, I get it, cool, but I need you to show me that you're real, because I'm having trouble.
With these eyes.
Yes, ma'am. So, but you know, I'm in a mind of a movie. Yeah. I'm thinking like a shooting star was going to come across the sky and, you know, wow me. Didn't happen.
What happened?
I turn around. And I was on the fourth floor. And the reason why I know the difference, because one of them had a centerpiece on it, right? Oh. It was a centerpiece. It was a flower. When I got off the elevator, when I turned around, that it was gone. And I'm like, and I went to the elevator. I'm like, what? I'm gone. I'm gone.
Leaking.
My sister gets off of the, like, she's like, I press the elevator, she's getting off, and I'm like, what floor is this?
Right.
Fourth floor is right here, but I was on the sixth floor.
Really?
So when that happened, I was like, okay.
All right.
You're real.
Yeah.
You're real.
A presence. Right? Your presence is known.
Yeah. So since then, it's like.
Yeah. Those inexplainable instances where it's like it cannot be explained, but it's felt. It's like
and experienced.
Physically. I'm not on the same floor I was on. Like, oh, you want to know I'm real? Let me take you down a peg or two. Yeah. Literally took you down a peg or two.
And the number four, right, the number of foundations. So we got to think about, you know, that's coming right now. So that let me know, okay, God is real. Yep. Cool. So I got it.
Yeah.
Now, later on, when I left the church, I was struggling with Jesus.
Okay.
Like, me, I knew God was real.
Yeah.
But it was something about Jesus I didn't understand.
Yeah.
Right? No, and so.
I have some things Yeah.
Oh yeah, we can. Yes, ma'am. And so with that, I left the church and I started to pursue knowledge everywhere. I studied a little bit of Hinduism. I studied a little bit of Buddhism. Taoism came a lot later down the line, but that's something I touched on. Sacred geometry, all that kind of stuff. And when I, in the beginning of that journey, I had a Holy Quran, but I never read it. I opened it and I saw Moses and Joseph, and I'm like, it's a Bible again. I dismissed the whole book. And then as a result of a client being killed, and when I was living in Rockford, I was invited to a Stop the Violence rally. Yeah. My girlfriend at the time was working that event. And so she told me it was happening. I knew the brother minister who is over the study group in Rockford. So I said, I can stroke two birds with one hand, you know, link up with the brother, support, right? You know, be in the community and whatnot. And it was a minister. His name is Nuri.
Yeah.
Nuri means light. Okay. So, right. Just these connections. So when I, got there, I heard that was November 12th, 2016.
Okay.
And from that day to, this one, I have not left the teachings. I didn't officially register until December 2017. But I was attending Mondays, which is men's class, men only, Wednesday nights and Sundays regularly. Like I was there, like I was a member. I was telling people about the teachings, bringing people to the mosque, to the study group that's out there.
Right.
But that's how it happened. And once it touched me, I couldn't get away from it at all.
Interesting. Wow. First of all, thank you for sharing. Yeah, that's really beautiful. Just to be able to refer back to the journey, and like you said, seeking truth. And just being led and guided to whatever it is that is needed for us to, you know, keep moving forward along our path. It's beautiful, and it's especially beautiful to share it because a lot of people don't like to talk about spirituality, religion, and stuff like that. It's very a very touchy subject. And I just want to mention that I love the fact that I can see your level of consciousness when you say stroke two birds with one hand instead of two birds with one stone. That is that little thing, that little detail is so significant because we often say things and are so unconscious of them. So like, why would I want to kill some birds?
Right. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Like that's what I wanted to say. And also, I wanted to talk about, because I'm a spiritual person. I've studied
I wanted to leeway into that because now, people, like, I'm in the Nation of Islam. I'm a practicing Muslim, right? Yeah. So I would fall in this box as somebody who's quote-unquote religious, right?
Yeah.
And you would fall in this box of someone who's spiritual. So that's what my question would be to you.
Yeah.
How do you define your spirituality, your spiritual journey? What is that like?
Okay. That's a loaded question. I'm really happy that you asked that. I don't think no one has ever asked it in that way. I just like to call it a lifestyle because it's my daily practices have come together in a way where it's like I took the teachings from the past, my past personally, and also my ancestors. So I pay a lot of homage to the ancestors, and not just, you know, our physical, you know, human ancestors, but also nature. And I, growing up, I didn't, I wasn't, my family didn't require me to go to church or anything like that. So I was always curious, like, oh, we don't go to church. Like, everybody else going to church, we don't go to church. I wanna know what church is about. Like, just a very curious person by nature. So I started to attend church with friends and just kind of, you know, get a feel of different churches, because, you know, they're all different, just like we're all different. It's one being, it's one entity. So I did that going along my journey, like just trying out, just sampling a few different things, I quickly identified that Christianity wasn't for me. Because number one, most of the churches that I went to, they would have pictures of a Jesus, you know, on a cross or, you know, something like that. And he didn't look like me, or he was a white dad. Yeah. He didn't look like my father. He didn't look like my brother. He didn't look like my uncle. And I'm just like, why? Okay. Oh, and then another experience that I had that really opened the gateway to me pursuing my seeking knowledge and seeking truth is, mm-hmm. It was a play I went to in high school. I don't remember the name of this play, but all I know is everyone was so excited to see this play because our teacher was telling us, preparing us, because we were in high school, like, there may be some nudity in this play. And we like, what? Nudity? So kids, we like, oh, okay, let's see this play. So we get to the play, and there's no nudity because they knew high school kids were coming in. But the entire play was about African people, you know, being taken from Africa and brought to America, and how they were, their spirituality and their religion was oppressed and suppressed. Like they had these little figures of little gods and deities that they used to praise and, you know, communicate with and pay homage to, that they had to hide from, you know, the adversary. I don't like
slave masters.
Yeah, the adversary.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So they had to hide themselves because they were forced to read this Bible and to praise this person on this cross and to also just give so much energy to God and not the goddess. What about the goddess? Our African our ancestors used to pray. Like, if we go, because I feel those who seek truth and, you know, dabble into all of the religions, we all see, like how you said, the Quran was like, oh, Moses and you know, all these other characters that were in the same book as Christianity, yes. They all correlate to, they all come back or trickle down to Egyptian mythology or Chemetian knowledge. Mm-hmm. And ancient Kemet, there were gods and goddesses. So it's like, why do so many religions pay so close attention to the God and not the goddess.
Okay. I think I feel where you moving, what direction you moving in, you know, spirit. Like take over God, right? Well, the first thing what I would like to add something to. We're taught in the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad that 1555 was when the first slave ship was brought over here.
Yes.
And that year, 1555, becomes significant. I'll speak on that after this point. But on a ship named Jesus, that we're told that 1619 is the day or is the year where, you know, slavery started. But there are 64 years of hidden history where the slave masters were forcing childbearing and would kill off the parents to disconnect the children from the root. And so they would be born cut off from the root into perpetual slavery. And the 1555 becomes, it's significant. And the man name is John Hawkins. So it was John Hawkins on a ship named Jesus. The 1555 becomes significant. Now, this is where I guess the religious part of me kicks in, but I think it's important to, we have to appreciate the scriptures because I mean, I have like, you know, How to Get Rich by Wallace D. The Science of Getting Rich by Wallace D. Waddles. As a Man Thinking.
Right.
We have those, the Napoleon Hills, right? These great books. What I'm working with now is called the Master Key by Lauren LaRon. Good stuff, right?
Yes.
But this book hasn't been around for 1400 years. You know, and where people are reading this book pretty regularly.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
As a Man Think, it hasn't been around for 2,000 years. These scriptures have been around and been relevant for a very long time. And so nothing is a coincidence. So we got to think about that. As far as that 1555 goal, connecting that with the scriptures, Genesis 15 and 12 through 15, there's a conversation God is having with Abraham. And he said, know of a surety that your seed will be afflicted in a strange land with a strange people for 400 years, right? So after that time, I will come, deliver them, judge the people who had oppressed them, and send them out of that land with great sustenance.
Right.
That no other people, and we can check our history, but no other people have been slaves under a strange people in a strange land for that duration of time, but Black people in America. So were we looking at history or were we looking at prophecy?
Right.
That was told before time that we would ultimately walk into.
I'm really happy that you brought that up because I go really deep into, like I say, ancient Kemetian knowledge. And Thoth, I don't know if you know who Thoth
is. Hermes Trismegistus.
Hermes Trismegistus said the same exact thing. And as a reference, there's a book by the name of the Emerald Tablets by, or it's called the Commandum of the Emerald Tablets by Billy Carson. And Billy Carson is a wonderful teacher and philosopher and scientist. He really knows how to paint a picture and merge the spirituality and spirituality, science, religion, all of these things, and give it and present it in such an easily digestible way, especially for, you know, Black people, because he is a brother himself. So, and he goes a lot into, like I said, Thoth, he wrote the book, The Commandment of the Emerald Tablets. And those teachings are just that. It's just, he's saying, like, you know, the people of Kim will be taken from Kim. And there will be the day upon my arrival when, you know, I'll be judging who is, you know, weighing your heart against the feather. And it's like hearing all of these different stories, they all come back to like the ancient teachings of Kemet.
The world's people. Yes, ma'am. So, and I don't want to get too far from the point of addressing the divine feminine.
Yes.
on that line, I would like to present again from the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. We're taught that the original man, which is us, you and I, when I say man, I mean man and woman.
Right.
We write our history in advance and then walk into it. We write our history based on a 25,000 year cycle. Based on the circumference of the planet Earth, 24,896 miles, approximately 25,000 miles. So we write our history a year to every mile in circumference. That the scriptures, I mean, even the Bible, is a portion of that 25,000 year cycle. The Holy Quran is it. Well, we start with the Torah, right?
Right.
From the Torah to, I mean, because this is what we have in this dispensation of time. This 6,000 year period is very important. But the Torah, the Injil, the New Testament, and then the Holy Quran by Prophet Muhammad Ibn Abdullah, peace be upon him. These are parts of a larger book. This history that's written out. To you know, we walk into what it is we want to happen. That connection with Hermes Trismegistus, I have the Emerald Tablets of Thoth. I've read it 19 times. You're supposed to read it 100, but I stopped because Islam came and it took all of my attention and focus, because when I started getting teachings, so many things started to connect, and that was one of them. So you have these Christ figures.
Yeah,
I think Horus is one of them. Quetzalcoatl is one of them with the Mayans. And of course Jesus. This is out of, you know, what's called the Middle East or whatever the case may be. But you have these Christ figures, these prophetic symbols prophetic pictures of men who would come in the last day to destroy, that's typical language, to destroy the world and establish a new world based upon these sublime principles or righteous principles, if you will.
Okay.
So when you see that, just you're in the right spirit with everything is all together, right? But the important thing is connecting that to the present time. We were taught to look at prophecy like history. And so we may come across something prophetical like that with the Emerald Tablets of Thoth, come across something prophetical, but it's taken as historical. Or the prophetical significance of it isn't espoused enough.
Right.
Where we can start to layer it over into what's happening in 2020.
Right.
What's happening today. And who are these people, people fulfilling these prophecies mm-hmm. right now.
Yeah.
And the common theme is us.
Yes.
Black people in America.
Always comes back to us.
We're very important to the grand scheme of this thing. Yeah. Very important. And many of us don't realize that.
Yeah.
I want to touch your question though. Because you asked why are women? What was the question? You said why are women recognized or?
Yeah, it's just a lot of energy given to the divine masculine.
Mm-hmm.
For so long, the divine feminine has, you know, just been in the shadows, like cast aside. Like, oh, this is for the boys. You do the little housework and stuff like that with the girls. And it's like, what? Like we're teachers too. We're prophets too. We are here to
contribute,
right. We need each other.
Yeah, this isn't a one-legged show, right?
Yeah, it's not. We need two legs to walk. We need two legs.
Beautiful thing about the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's teachings.
Uh-huh.
And you'll catch me continuously saying this man's name because
yes,
it wasn't until I got what he taught, mm-hmm. teach this to this higher understanding started to really take hold.
Okay.
3/4 of his work
mm-hmm.
is with the woman.
Mm-hmm.
That's different for one, because we don't typically see that focus put on women. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said that you do not judge a civilization by the man. Mm. You judge a civilization by the woman.
Right.
He also said that if you teach a man, you teach an individual.
Yes.
If you teach a woman, you teach a nation.
Mm-hmm. Ashe.
Right? So it's not in the nation of Islam where the woman is oppressed.
Right.
Where the woman's significance isn't promoted.
Okay.
The Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan's national spokesperson is student minister Dr. Ava Muhammad.
Okay.
At one point in time, she was put over a mosque in Atlanta.
Mm-hmm.
You don't see, you know, this is one of the pieces of the misconceptions that's had about Islam. Now, as far as the Orthodox world,
mm-hmm.
we do see suppression of women.
Mm-hmm.
But we also see a great civilization.
Mm-hmm.
established on the revelation of the Holy Quran coming down.
Right.
And that is in direct relation to the treatment of the woman. The reason why the world is in the condition that it's in right now, as taught by the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, is because of the treatment of the woman.
Right.
Going to the Holy Quran, the two most significant persons in the Holy Quran is, or most mentioned, you find that is Moses and Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
I want to focus on Jesus.
Okay.
Jesus is, and I, you know, I said earlier how I had a problem with Jesus and now I don't at all.
Yeah. Okay.
But if we look at Jesus,
mm-hmm.
Jesus is the only messenger or prophet mentioned in the Holy Quran where his mother is associated with him.
Mm.
It's always Isa ibn Maryam. Mm. Jesus, Mary, mother of Jesus.
Right.
Without Mary, there is no Jesus.
Right.
There is no Messiah.
Right.
Without that man
mm-hmm.
coming through the womb of a very special woman.
Mm-hmm.
chapter 19, the number 19 is very significant. Number 19 is the signature of God. The entire Quran is permeated with the 19th mathematical code. I'll send you a link. You know, once we're done, wrapped up, and you can look over it yourself. But it was a man by the name of Rashad Khalifa who discovered the 19th mathematical code of the Holy Quran. Okay. But 19 is very significant because you have Alpha and Omega.
Right.
Yeah, the right, the one and the nine. Now, chapter 19 is Maryam. Nothing is a coincidence. So I think that, I know that we have been led towards the disrespect, the mistreatment, the abuse and neglect of the woman. But it's only from what I've you know, bore witness to, being from different schools of thought and settling on the best part in Islam under the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. It's only here where the woman is put in her proper place. We don't call the black woman a goddess. The black woman is the second self of Allah. You mentioned in Kemet, right?
Right.
They were always together. Masculine, feminine.
Always.
Right? The second self, meaning, you know, we're taught in the teaching study on Elijah Muhammad that when Allah, the first God, self-created, he saw in himself another self. Not a lesser self.
Right.
Another self.
A reflection.
And he brought that self out.
Right. Yeah. I tell that to my partner and the love of my life, Ajiano, all the time. Like, I am a reflection of you. You are a reflection of me. And we both together, I embody the divine masculine as well as the divine feminine. And he embodies the divine feminine as well as the divine masculine. And just to touch on what you said about our current state being due to the treatment or mistreatment of women, it's also I love looking up at the stars. Like, I like gazing above and, you know, beyond and saying, like, what's up there, you know, stuff like that. But also seeing this living organism that we are habitants of, Mother Earth. A lot of what we're going through now is because of, you know, the mistreatment of Mother Earth and all of her children, all of the inhabitants, not only human beings, but animals, you know. The earth is in nature feminine. And I consider myself a medicine woman, or just a healer. And being connected with the earth is like, she provides everything that we need, you know. Everything comes from the earth. We are a part, you know, of the earth. So it's like, just really taking care of the divine feminine. Like you say, you teach a woman, you teach a nation. So it's just like planting a seed, you know. You plant a seed in the earth's soil, and one day the seed, you know, it'll grow over time, and one day the tree will bear fruit. And then you can also use the tree to make a house.
Multiple uses.
Yeah.
Through the woman.
Yes.
And we see this in the case of Jesus. Jesus is a prophetical figure. Mm-hmm. Right? That's important to note. According to the scriptures, all of the signs have come where the work of the Messiah, that the work of the Messiah is being done, the signs of the end times being present.
Right.
We know that that 400 year period being over,
yeah,
a focus should be on not the coming of God, but the presence of God at this point. And being that he is present, who are the persons fulfilling, you know, these roles?
Mm-hmm.
But going back to Jesus and tying this to the significance of the woman, the secret of God is in the woman's womb. So when you are pregnant with child, we know that water picks up thoughts, it absorbs thought, and it takes the shape of thoughts, right?
Yes.
So that child is in a sack of water. And so think about the intimate connection between the woman and that child. So are you drinking alcohol while you're pregnant? Are you watching unbecoming things while you're pregnant? Maybe scary movies, listening to music that promotes death, or something that is degenerative. What are you thinking about? How is your self-esteem?
Right.
Are you praying? Are you meditating? Right. Are you cleansing? Are you focusing on the life developing and giving your attention to the life developing in your womb?
Right.
And so when you have a woman that is near and seeks to be near to God, a woman who's prayed up, a woman who's in her spirituality, a woman who's practicing sincerely her religion,
right?
What you have is a co-creation happening with God, right? And so think about the importance of what you contribute, what you are contributing to that life, and what the end product is as a result of your being and your state of mind.
Right.
That the woman is so valuable. That's why in the nation we're very serious about our women.
Yes.
And being taught the value of it, and then, you know, having examples, the best example really in front of us, we can't dismiss that, we can't disregard that, because we know that every human except the first God, right? The very first God is self-created. After him,
right,
everybody else,
as an extension,
has come through the womb of a woman.
If you have a belly button, you came from a woman.
Everybody else, man and woman included.
Yeah.
So where does that put you? And what responsibility is on us as men?
Yeah.
And what responsibility is on you as a woman?
Yeah.
Take care of yourself and to reverence your womb. And it's also us brothers who must take care of ourselves and also to reverence the womb. But you get where I'm coming from, though. This is the significance of the woman.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's beautiful. I love that you talk about the taking care of ourselves physically, mentally, spiritually, in all ways, especially when we're pregnant. I see a lot of times today where, you know, we as women are not really conscious of the fact that we are creators, and we have, we are portals. We are, you know, we have to nurture ourselves in order to be able to nurture the future, you know, to bring forth harmony and light onto the planet, into the entire universe. And that's why I love connecting with women, because one, I'm a woman, I can relate a little bit more to a woman. And just the fact that speaking about meditating or praying and eating healthy foods, high vibrational music, high vibrational media, what you watch on TV, all that stuff, all of those different avenues are different ways in which we consume and digest, you know, you call it nutrients. So whatever we're taking in through the eyes, whatever we're taking in through the ears, whatever we're saying, and also being spoken to, or whatever, you know, the messages that we are receiving is really crucial to the development of our offspring, an extension of us, an extension of source. Like you said, there was the one creator that created itself, and I call it source. And everything is an extension of source. So just knowing that, I feel as though a lot of people, especially women, not especially women, just a lot of people in general, aren't really conscious of the fact that we are all creators. Mm-hmm. We all, you know, have this ability to produce, and not so much consuming. Because all we do all day, I'm actually on a fast right now. This is my sixth day on a 21-day fast, and I'm feeling amazing. I got past all of my hunger cravings and stuff like that, but just, you know, taking time out and really relaxing on consuming. Yum, 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 yum. Give me this, give me this, give me that. And like, we're working, all of us are working so hard to be able to consume things. Mm-hmm. And then it's like, we don't give ourselves an opportunity to relax and go within, right, cleanse, go within, connect to the earth, connect to our higher self, connect to God, spirit, whatever we like to, you know, envision it as. I feel as though I talk to a lot of my clients, and a lot of times I see people tend to struggle and suffer unnecessarily because of the fact that they're consuming more than they're producing. And when I'm talking about creation, it could be anything. Just like you said, your coach was telling you to focus on three things that you love. And in doing that on a fast or a cleanse, focusing on three things that you love, it's like you have all of this free time and energy to be able to produce something. So like now I'm like really practicing the ukulele and getting into producing my own music, just starting off with the basics, but producing my own music. I know you say you journaling, writing. I am going to, in the near future, write a book on the alkaline lifestyle and, you know, taking care of the mind, body, spirit. So, definitely. I know that a lot of religions focus on a time set aside for cleansing and detoxing and fasting. Can you talk a little bit about the Nation of Islam and fasting?
Yes, ma'am. Fasting is prescribed for us. Mm-hmm. So it's a prescription to affect the healing. Mm-hmm. When the body is is purified, is being purified, not taking in food, mm-hmm. and the blood, which is the life fluid of the body, mm-hmm. which we have more focus or more, we use our brain power more.
Right.
Because it's not dwelling in the digestive system. You know, this, I mean, we've grown as a society for the most part from this eating 3 meals a day. It's crazy. Because if it takes 24 hours for a meal to digest fully, right? So keyword fully. Mm-hmm. I just added one part of the intestines. I just added the stomach, but fully digested, be assimilated. Yeah. Then if we eat 3 meals a day, then at no time is our digestive system ever given rest. Yeah. And at no time are we using our brain power or, you know, to the potential that it could be used, where we are to push to a limit, to go past that limit or that level.
Right.
So we stay on it because we never, you know, go into those planes of thought, mm-hmm. because we aren't equipping ourselves to do so.
Right.
The Honorable Elijah Muhammad prescribed for us to eat one meal a day, meal every 24 hours, mm-hmm. at least.
Yes.
No, excuse me, at most one meal every 24 hours.
Okay.
Wait a minute. No. I don't know why I'm getting this at most, at least part mixed up. Uh-huh. But like, so no, never eat more than one meal every 24 hours, mm-hmm. and get to the point where you can eat one meal every 48 hours and get to the point where you can eat one meal every 72 hours. Mm-hmm. And then he says this in How to Eat to Live, book one.
Yes, I love that book.
You want to eat when you get hungry.
But a lot of us don't know when we're hungry.
A lot of us don't know that.
Mm.
So we may be experiencing a withdrawal, if you will, right? Mm-hmm. Or detoxing. And yeah. Her name is Sister Elaine Abdullah. Mm-hmm. She's I will call her a holistic practitioner. She does colon cleanses and foot mm-hmm. detoxes in Chicago.
Okay.
45 mm-hmm. for the colon cleanse and 35 for the foot detox is very affordable, and she has her prices set like that so that she can help Black people,
yes.
who may not be able to afford, you know, going to a doctor. You may be paying excess of 80 plus,
yes.
for, you know, something like
that. Yep. Mm-hmm.
But talking to her, mm-hmm. Oh goodness, and I think I just lost my point on that. So,
well,
let me just back around to the go ahead.
I was going to just ask a little bit more about this sister. You say she's in Chicago.
No, I can send you her information as well. So
yeah, that would be really helpful to a lot of people, because I know a lot of people, yeah, have been thinking of.
Now, here's the thing with uh-huh. Sister Elaine. Like, the number, you send that number directly to the person
who inquired.
Directly to that person
who inquired.
So don't post it.
Yeah.
Don't post it online.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Right. Okay. She don't want nobody coming after.
Yes. Yes, sir. Okay.
Okay. But to the point of Sister Elaine, she was like, I think I told her, like, man, I'm hungry. She was like, your stomach not right there. I'm like, what? Wow. Like, that's not your stomach. That's your intestines.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you're up here.
That's your body detoxing. And I'm like, oh man, never knew that, right? So, mm-hmm. I mean, that let me know that I obviously there's been some miseducation there.
Yeah.
But giving your body the time to detox, mm-hmm. Then you can maximize the spirit of life in you.
Yes.
So following that prescription from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, eating simple foods, eating the best foods that you can afford, right? It saves money. And it also, it helps to vitalize the body, revitalize the body, and regenerate the body.
Yeah.
I before Islam, it was a picture of me I had posted up a little while ago, maybe like a year and a half ago. I was 19 on one picture, and another picture, I was like a year into Islam, and I looked younger on that picture than I did when I was 19 years old.
Totally rejected.
And this is, you know, striving to follow the dietary law.
Yeah.
And he also says that fasting would cure 90% of our ills.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I have a feeling like to shoot up a little bit more. Like I want to almost say 95.
Yeah.
I want to say he said more than 90, but I know it was at least 90% of our ills. And forgive me for not having that right and exact. But at least 90% of our ills can be cured from fasting.
Yeah. And I know a lot of people are aware of the late great Dr. Sebi and his teachings on, you know, alkaline foods and also using fasting and detoxing as a way of healing any ailments naturally. He talks about the bioelectric nature of especially melanated beings, and just the way in which Dr. Sebi presents his research and his teachings, it all correlates, it all coincides, it's the same thing. And what he focuses on is the specific foods that will give you the highest amount of energy. All this energy, we're all energy. These physical bodies all are made up of trillions and trillions of cells that are powered by electric energy. As soon as anyone comes to me as a client, I'll tell them to embark on the divine detox. So a 7-day detox. And shout out to one of my very, very good friends, Madison, who he just recently finished a 7-day detox. He never detoxed before in his life, never fasted or anything like that. And he really took this practice, this prescription seriously. And the benefits were amazing. Just an overall increased energy, like you said, being able to utilize and maximize on our brain power, or the mental clarity that comes through is unexplainable. it's an entire experience in itself. And it's like every day of a fast is like a year's worth of consuming, you know, foods, whether it be, you know, high vibrational foods or low vibrational foods. It's like, you know, just sweeping away the rubbish and the toxins and all of that.
More energy.
Yeah.
Right. More focus and clarity. Yeah. You're gonna concentrate better. Mm-hmm. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said that every 3 days you fast, that is, you advance spiritually.
Yeah.
All right. So you're on day 6. Mm-hmm. So you can 2 spiritual leaps from the you started up until, you know, right now. And you said 21 days?
Yes, 21 days out.
So you can expect that, you can expect 6. No. No, you can expect 7.
Mm.
7 at least. And you're just doing water and tea?
Right now I'm doing green smoothies, green juices, tea, water.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So, yeah, it's a beautiful experience. Very, I don't know why people have such a fear. There's this fear around not eating. It's like, oh no, I can't not eat. I'll die. Like,
and this is what, and this kind of leeways into something else I wanted to touch on while we do have this time together.
Mm-hmm.
Because what I've come to see is that regardless if you're in the religious community or in the spiritual community, I consider myself to be in both, right? Because I'm a practicing Muslim.
Yeah.
But I do also consider myself more spiritual than I am dogmatic. Okay. Now, there are rules, of mm-hmm. course, mm-hmm. and those rules are set up for our benefit.
Right.
David says, the law is like a lamp unto my feet. Mm-hmm. So the law guides us. Mm-hmm. We have a restrictive law of Islam. Mm-hmm. One of the restrictive laws is to not take in any intoxicants.
Right. No alcohol. No.
If I drink, mm-hmm. and I can get drunk, I can become other than myself.
Spirits.
I'm out of my natural mind. Mm. And that could lead me to do something that I wouldn't do because I would be inhibited by my consciousness from doing something. Right? But if I don't drink, then that can never be actualized unless, of course, I'm poisoned. Right. But there's other restrictive laws that keep you away from certain kind of conversations. Mm-hmm. And will keep you away from certain kind of people.
Yeah.
Right? So
yeah.
The law is important for us to have if we really want to, you know, climb up that level mm-hmm. of awareness of the God presence, which in Islam or Arabic is called taqwa, God consciousness. Mm-hmm. And essentially that's the wherever you go, it's like God is there with you.
Yes.
So would you do what you're doing if God was like over your shoulder? Like,
right. Like, hey, I see you doing that. I see you.
Probably won't.
Right.
But if I was to, if I can never not be a Muslim at this point. This is my life's journey. I love it. I love Islam. Okay. Because it's a way of life.
Yeah.
And I'm learning it more and more, and, you know, and becoming more myself in it. Mm-hmm. Now, but regardless, there is a knowledge and an understanding and an awareness of things and the time that I have as a result mm-hmm. of being under the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Mm-hmm. As a spiritual person, you have knowledge, mm-hmm. you have understanding, mm-hmm. you have an experience of practicing some of the things that you practice. I don't know if you use crystals.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so I got a couple right here. Mm-hmm. All right. You do some sage burning?
Yeah.
Some sage burning?
Oh, the sage is in my other room, but my incense
are about it. I had bow bow around the whole
right. Thing. Right. You got everything handy, I guess.
So, but, okay, so, you know,
yeah.
What is science?
Yeah.
These.
What's the science?
Like, we're using them. What is the science of these? Crystals amplify thoughts. Yeah. That's one of their abilities. I just read an article in preparation for this conversation from Mother Tynetta. Mm-hmm. She was one of the wives of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Okay. And she wrote that the masculine crystals do the healing, right? Yeah. And the feminine ones are the ones that enhance the thought. That's something I had just learned today. But you're using these things in your practices. And I can send you that article as well. Mm-hmm. You're using these things in your practices, right? To become a better you.
Yes.
To affect self-improvement.
Yeah.
But that gives you a responsibility to the people who do not have it.
Yes.
And so where is the dividing line mm-hmm. between religion and spirituality if mm-hmm. it comes down to the knowledge that we have?
Yeah.
And the responsibility that's to be had to lift those
right.
who don't have what we have.
Right.
In service of source.
Yes.
In service of Allah, the creator, yes. the originator. Yes. That's the question I'm posing.
So where's the line between spirituality and religion?
Yeah, how are we so divided?
I don't know,
the communities.
That is a great question, because everything that we're saying is one and the same. So there is really, like I always say, everything is everything. We are on our individual paths, yes, but at the end, at the end of it all, and there is no end. There is no beginning. There is no end. So it's like, it all just is. It all just is. We are all just here. You know, especially in this time, everyone is being elevated to a higher consciousness. And like you said, that our roles and our responsibilities to uplift and shine light and share the knowledge that we know is we're on the same mission. We have the same, it's one team. It's one team. There are no, yeah. And even just writing up, making the Zoom meeting for this, I'm like writing spirituality versus religion. I'm like, is it really like a, is this really like a match? Like, are we really?
No, I found that people are, people are turned off.
Yeah. Why?
From each other because of the positions that, you know, that you may particularly take. Like in my case, right? I'm a Muslim. I mean, I have family members who, I mean, it's gotten better now at this point, but I do know that certain things are said about me.
Okay.
Right. Because of this path that I'm on. And this is a divide within religion, right? Because if God is one God, in Arabic, his name is Allah.
Yeah.
Right. But in God is, in English is God, and in French is Du. In what Swahili is Shungu, and Chinese is Xi'an. So what are we divided for? Now that's just within, that's in a religion, right? But one God, one truth, one light, right? But those who you know, because I don't have my Islam, If you've seen any of my posts, every day I'm because I believe in my heart that it's relevant and I believe it's useful, especially in this time. And not just useful, it's needed in this time. The guidance that's coming from the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, which is coming from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. So, but people say, oh, you're a Muslim. Y'all oppressed with, because these perceptions that's out, y'all oppressed with, oh, I don't do all of that. I don't pray, or you know what I'm saying, or you don't, five times a day maybe too much for you. Or I'm giving my will to somebody else. And so I'm not free in religion. Right. And that's another thing that may, you know, rub people the wrong way, but I'm nobody's fool. Right. I come out of the spiritual community, right? So that's why I want these things to be reconciled, because I see great people in both. But let's touch the spiritual side.
Okay.
Who are you in submitting? Who are you submitting to? Well, I'm free. Free. Okay. So free what? So what are you moving towards?
Right.
You say your higher self. What does that look like? And do you have to apply practices consistently in order to get there? Do you have to submit to greater knowledge to rise up to those heights that you could not rise up to unless the knowledge had been presented? And then can you even access it without a teacher? Somebody to show you or to demonstrate it in some type of way, where you can go, once you get it, you know, seek it on your own. But then some degrees of knowledge, like I can open up a psychology book,
right?
I wouldn't be qualified to work in it until the qualifications was conferred upon me by one proven who has fruit in that field, who could say such and such has now gotten to a point where they now work in this field on their own because they've proven themselves.
Right.
So the master teacher relationship, you know, if you know about Hermes Trismegistus, you should know about the Kabbalion.
Mm-hmm.
Master appears when the student
is ready.
Is ready.
Yeah.
Mm. So who can teach man for all intents and purposes, because you're aware of this, where you are in your stage of development. You know, most of us live on an animalistic plane.
Yeah, the lower vibration.
So, lower vibrational.
Yeah.
So nothing happens out of a vacuum between human beings. Mm-hmm. There is no, oh my God, I'm conscious, I'm woke.
Right.
There's laws of cause and effect that are always at play.
Mm-hmm.
Now, because we have a subconscious realm, you may not always be able to readily grab hold or to recall where this impression came from, but it came from somewhere, and more importantly, it came from somebody.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there is an avoidance there of, not in your case, Denise, I'm saying, in generally speaking, what I've seen is there is an avoidance of some accountability.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a rejection of, there's an ego issue at hand.
Ego.
Because when God is a man, proven by knowledge, wisdom, and understanding and power that he's exercised his fruits and his witness, and that witness, those witnesses do a work. A work in a place where, for all intents and purposes, it is impossible. Where do you stand in relation to this work being done, the truth that's espoused, and the decision you make to either at least investigate it or completely?
Right.
No, I'm spiritual.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And so I see ego on both sides, because some of us, you got crystal, that's witchcraft.
Oh, what? Not a crystal ball. That's definitely witchcraft.
You're a gypsy, you're something.
Right.
You know that.
Pulses
and everything. It's like, wait a minute. Does your body have crystals in them? Are you an electromagnetic being?
Yes.
Does these have an electrical current to it where it can amplify certain energy channels that are present in a body, as we know by Eastern medicine? What is the effect of the smell, right, of sage?
Right.
What does it do? What effect does it produce in a body, being that you're burning something, it's transforming, transmuting in front of you? Okay, what is it? What is the effect that it has on the person, of your mind, of your spiritual well-being? The food that you eat, what effect does it have for you to eat a slab of chicken ribs? I've been there, I've done that, right? No more. Then you eating you a nice salad, or maybe a turkey burger, you know what I'm saying? But something cleaner. Now you into all of this meditation. You pray. Isn't that a form of meditation?
Yes, connecting. That's why I always say that everything is everything. I don't know I know you're probably aware of the story of the Tower of Babel. The Tower of Babel, and it's like, I don't want to take up too much time, but I'm really loving this, by the way. You know, the Tower of Babel is like, you know, all of these men are working on the tower, and then someone or something or whatever, I'm not, you know, very my thinking is not really linear. It's more like a it's a curved path, not a straight path. So
circles and lines.
Yes. So the Tower of Babel is like, all these men were working on this tower, you know, on the same mission, you know, the same in goal in mind, and someone or something comes in and takes away their ability to communicate and their ability to, and then the tower never gets finished.
Yes, ma'am.
If we're building a monument or a building or anything, and we can't communicate with each other and say, hey, I need to lay this brick here and you need to put that pole there and blah, 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 it's never going to get finished. But I see that as like, you know, the planet as a whole, the universe as a whole. Because if we can't be able to just openly communicate, ask questions, and you know, say how did you become who you are and what did you do to get what you have and stuff like that, instead of just like in our own minds assuming, just, you know, creating a story for someone else. Like, you know, a lot of people in my family, you know, do that as well. Not a lot, but I know a lot of people would see me and be like, oh, she's a witch, she's this, she's that. And it's really, we're really all doing the same things. Like, we are all same being.
Well, I'll say there may be some disagreement with that, and you may not find me too disagreeable. But it's something that one, we can assume, right? And we can make a judgment and not understand.
Right.
But you said something about asking questions. Ask questions to learn all about yourself.
Yeah.
That's the way to go.
Yeah.
But this is something that I noticed, that you switch between, you said someone and something. Right? But a thing is subject to you.
Yeah. Right.
You're not subject to a thing unless you subject yourself to a thing.
Right.
The only God a human being can submit to is another human being. Other than that, there is no goal for us. And so, and this is out of both worlds. And this is why I believe, you know, more conversations need to be had about who and what we are.
Yes.
In a conscious community, we say we're gods.
Yes.
In religion, or, you know, the Bible, some people don't even won't embrace that at all. We say it's, no, I'm not God. Okay, well, okay, that's cool. Ye are all God's children of the Most High God, but it's in the scriptures. So let's just say we go on the extreme, right? So we have this understanding.
Okay.
Now, on one end, the negation of not being able to submit to anything but a man, what do we do by saying that we're not this? Or what do we do by making God a thing and not a human being? And we understand the power of language and the power of words. Do we not remove ourselves from achieving and overcoming the impossible?
Right.
By removing ourselves from the God, by saying what we're not, or making the God something other than what he actually is. I think we have to be more conscious of that. And I respect, and I, because I've learned over these last 4 years, really, because it's really 2016. But I've learned over these last 4 years how heavy the truth is. And I know some people even have problems with me saying truth.
Yeah.
How heavy the truth is of the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Because we can go into depth on things that most people have not heard. And I've been very careful about not doing that here, because you never know what a person can handle. And so let the dialogue
go to the sister.
Yeah, no,
I
had a conversation with my sister, and I went over the teachings with her, and she was like she cursed me out.
Oh,
not like disrespectful, but she was like,
something is triggered. Like, what?
She, because listen, when you hear something you've never heard before from the person who all praise belongs to Allah can explain it, and I'm saying it like I'm going over, mm-hmm. you know, 1 + 1 = 2.
Mm-hmm.
You like, wait, what? Mm-hmm. And I, you know, it's different if I act all deranged and eccentric with it, and like, no, this is, and it's like, no, listen, that's it happened, and you brushing over like it's nothing, but that person is like, and they've never heard it before. It can damage a person's mind.
Yeah,
it really can. Dealing with things. Say that again.
Kind of makes us stuck for a little while, and we like keep going over that. Keep going over that. Instance in our mind, like, wait,
what? Right, what did you just say?
Right.
And so it can be very dangerous, but with us, we believe very simply that God is a man.
Mm-hmm.
We believe that the scripture is being fulfilled through Black people.
Mm-hmm.
Now, of course, the whole of humanity is being affected, and I keep going back to Jesus, because Jesus, that Jesus we've read about, we learned about, it's a prophetic, he's a sign of one to come in the last day.
Mm-hmm.
And when I say the last day, you know, we're in this, what, shift, paradigm shift? Mm-hmm. If we're in a paradigm shift, then that means we're coming out of something,
mm-hmm.
into something.
Mm-hmm.
So something is dying and something is being birthed.
Right.
We call it the kingdom of God.
Mm-hmm.
Some people call it the new world order. Some people call it going up into the fourth dimension.
Right.
Whatever the language might be for you, I'm not here to weave and duck and cut through all of that.
Mm-hmm.
But the important focus is that on who we are,
mm-hmm.
the men that have come and have done the work and are doing the work,
mm-hmm.
that is affecting the whole of humanity, but the focus being on us. And where we stand in that as Black people.
Mm-hmm.
If you can't believe or you can't grab hold to point number 12 and what the Muslims believe, it's on the back page of every Final Call newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
This is a great Black publication. It's not a religious publication. Like, it's about Black people
doing obviously in the world. World news. But
why we can't trust the vaccines, and who else is putting this, and you know, trying to get this word out to Black people like that,
right,
man.
Right.
We always fact check. But point number 12 simply says that we believe that Allah,
mm-hmm.
came in the person of Master Fard Muhammad,
mm-hmm.
the Bakhti Messiah, that he's going to establish a government of peace,
mm-hmm.
freedom, justice, and equality. That's point number 12. And that's a foundational point for us.
Right.
If you can't grab hold to that, that's fine. Mm-hmm. My spiritual people,
mm-hmm.
but don't take yourself out of the equation, or don't take yourself out of your potential by dismissing something that when you connect to helps you to see yourself better,
mm-hmm.
quickens you to kind of refine a little bit more and a little bit faster. Because if God came in the person of a human being, born in 1877,
mm-hmm.
through the womb of a woman,
mm-hmm.
what does that say about the woman and her ability to produce what the product of her womb can be?
Mm-hmm.
And what does that say about human beings as far as what we can achieve with knowledge, wisdom, understanding, and submission to, for a softer language, a master teacher.
Mm-hmm. Right. So what I wanted to touch on just briefly before we get out of here.
I know we've been chopping it up for a while. I'm enjoying it.
I'm still going to go live on YouTube. I go live every Thursday at 3 p.m. Central Standard Time on Divine Fitness Blog.
Man, I called one of your episodes before.
Really? Thanks.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm so happy that you joined. Always welcoming people into the sacred space. So I just wanted to touch on some of the verbiage that you use and how it's it may kind of, like you said, words are very powerful. Like I say words are spells. Like, oh, you saying like when we were talking about killing two birds with one stone, it's like, why would you put that type of energy out there versus
strong atmosphere?
Yeah. So like you're saying submit. I say surrender. Because if we look at those two words, they kind of elicit a certain response in the body, in your energetic field. It kind of submit is a little bit heavier than surrender. Like surrender is like breathe.
Mm-hmm.
Or submit is like, okay, whatever you say. You know?
Because
it's like, and the restrictive law, mm-hmm. like restriction. It's like restriction and I would say expansion. Both of those mm-hmm. words have like a different feel to them. They have a certain frequency and vibration to them. So, mm-hmm. As for me, just me personally, I can't speak for anyone else.
Yes, ma'am.
It's like,
is it difficult to receive?
It doesn't resonate with me personally.
Mm-hmm.
But that word, like submit versus surrender, and restriction versus creation or expansion. So like, you know, we're all on our, like I say, our individual paths, but certain things or certain, like, you know, verbiage and language, and it's very powerful, very, very powerful. And if we aren't really aware or have a certain level of consciousness, I feel as though that can do us a little bit of you know, damage, because it's like, oh, I didn't look at it that way. I didn't look at it as one word being contracting and one word being expansive. Like, mm-hmm. it's like kind of like we were talking about the like love-based philosophies versus of something fear, like, oh, you have to do this or this is going to happen. Because you have mm-hmm. spiritual teachers. I was working with a spiritual coach, and she would tell me, you need these crystals, because if you don't have these crystals, mm-hmm. negative energy will follow you wherever you go. And I'm like, huh.
That's interesting, right?
Right. And after working with her, I appreciated the knowledge that she gave me. But it's mm-hmm. like, you know, we always take what we need and leave the rest behind. It's like, we don't just, you know, gobble up everything. You know, whatever resonates with you. Whatever your truth is your truth. Whatever, you know, we're all having our individual human experience.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I want to hear your thoughts on, just those, that simple thing, those little words or verbiage being used that can possibly take us, restrict, contract us or expand us. Is it fear-based, like, or is it love-based, like, So I want to hear your thoughts.
Yes, ma'am. So I hear you.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like for you to correct me if I move in error
okay.
on the line I'm about to attempt to touch.
Okay.
So because women have been put in such a defiled condition, mm-hmm. and then there's this expectation there that's still supposed to be like, right, mm-hmm. submit.
Yeah, because we'll naturally submit to any man who is.
No. I disagree. I disagree with that. Right. I believe that it is a woman's nature to submit mm-hmm. to a man that mm-hmm. she recognizes God in.
Ashe.
Okay. Now, if you not manifesting your godhood, or at least striving to manifest your godhood where you give the sister something to work with.
Yeah.
It's unrealistic for you to expect her to submit to what she cannot submit to. Mm-hmm. But because the woman is a God herself. Mm-hmm. Gotcha. She is God herself. Mm-hmm. So the only way she's going to bow is if and when she recognizes
right.
God in you. Mm-hmm. So it's like, oh,
I see you,
and you,
yeah.
right. You understand? Right, you understand. So mm-hmm. I think submission has a particular mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Repelling effect.
Yeah, repulsion. Like,
yes, ma'am, repulsion.
Yeah.
However, it is important to clear words.
Yeah.
Because words, if they can trigger mm-hmm. us, then that's something within us and maybe on a cellular level, mm-hmm. right, that's activated by these words. And so we're responding out of a moment in our life that is not the present moment.
Right.
Or we're reacting out of the past yeah. and not responding to the present moment. Okay. But when we can clear the words and we understand the words, like we go to the definition of what does it mean to submit, mm-hmm. we get that understanding for ourselves, then that it loses its charge because understanding has come and you're working with the definition, with the knowledge and the consciousness of where you are from present time.
Yes.
Yeah. So in the vein of the word submission, okay?
Yeah.
Now the principle of it is this. Mm-hmm. I take for instance a basketball player. If you want to be a great basketball player,
yeah,
you would have to meet a great coach mm-hmm. who, because relationships are important for this reason, we're naturally biased. Some of us are good at recognizing our flaws. We can't see everything because mm-hmm. we're not, our eyes are made to look out, not within.
Mm.
Oh, but in my relationship with a sister, my relationship with my brother, mm-hmm. that person, because of the dynamic of our relationship, sees things in me, of me, of good and bad that I may not recognize, catch patterns of speech that I may not recognize. Mm-hmm. Same goes in a case. So I'm bringing that point to, for example, like a coach. Yeah. So that coach is going to see things in you mm-hmm. that you won't be able to see. He may say, no, you, this brother really got a talent for shooting. You might not think you're a great shooter per se, right. but right. he's like, no, the footwork and mm-hmm. work on this shot from over here. You actually cleaner from over here than you are on this side. So go over here. Right. Mm-hmm. So that degree of submission, we always hear this, you have to be coachable.
Yeah.
Teachable.
Yeah, right.
You have to be willing to give your will over to somebody who knows more than you.
Yeah.
So you can develop the knowledge.
And implement. Not only gain, implement the knowledge.
And implement.
Right. Yeah.
So that's submission, mm-hmm. right? And so
yes.
In order to be a master, you must submit to a master so that master can develop you. We right. see it in the realm of martial arts as well. Mm-hmm. Oh, no, mm-hmm. I don't submit to nobody. Well, how you going to get a black belt unless you come by another black belt who can? No, technique right. not right, brother.
Right.
No, you need to work on your katas a little bit more, brother.
Yeah. Did you do martial arts, by the way?
I am working on getting myself involved with that, man, more and more. I can't say that I do it when I'm around brothers who really, really do it. I'm getting into that flow.
Okay, I was just, I don't know why I just saw, like, you in a...
I mean, because I've been around it enough where, like, it's an impression that's on my subconscious mind, so sooner or later it's going to manifest.
Yeah.
And I intentionally did that.
I see it.
Praise be to Allah. And that's another thing about our sisters. I know when a woman tell you something, she sees something, you know.
That intuition.
Y'all got it. Y'all got juice. Now,
A woman's intuition.
Always.
Yeah.
Now, the restrictive law.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I get it.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're told to be free.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And it's this idea of freedom and, well, you know, you telling me what to do, and I can't be told what to do. How you gonna restrict me, restrict my body, restrict my actions? I can do what I want to do. You can.
Right.
It's like you can go you can go outside and drive 90 miles down per hour, down a 35 mile zone. You can if you want to. Free man, free woman, and get yourself into an accident or get arrested.
Yeah.
Reckless driving and endangering the public or a ticket.
Yeah.
But there is a consequence for operating outside of the law, the safety net of the law.
Yes, absolutely.
The earth orbits
on
its axis 23 degrees to the plane of its axis 1,037 and 1/3 miles per hour.
Mm-hmm.
If it cuts out of its rotation, if out of that sphere, elliptical, but whatever, you know, the revolution. What is that going to do for everything else that's in perfect order? How is that going to throw off everything else? Now, in our life, right, we look at things very individualistic, but when we start to consider, like, the laws of cause and effect, what does this action have upon the collective conscious to touch that? Or what immediate effect would it have on this, that, and the third? What am I creating if there's a quote from the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, and I'm working on a blog right now.
Oh, nice.
My next one that I'll put out. I do write blogs.
Yeah.
And I've been getting more, yes, ma'am. I've been getting more consistent with them.
Yes,
sir. Something touched me recently, and I was just like, okay, I'm going to just start writing a little bit more.
You said,
brothers and sisters, the wickedly wise who rule this world understand that thought is produced by what you see, hear, and taste and feel. That through your senses, messages come and create thought. Yeah. And if they can control what you see, what you hear, what you taste, what you smell, they also can control how you feel and how you think, and they can predict your action and master you without your ever knowing that you are in 1980 at the time, a bigger slave than your parents were in 1680.
Yes. Yes, sir.
So, with the restrictive law, don't drink liquor. Don't drink any intoxicants. Again, I gave that example earlier, how because the thought you can get into, and I can bear witness from my own life, the reason why I slowed down on hard liquor before I stopped completely was because I realized how animalistic I became when I became intoxicated. I hope I've never had no bad experience with you, Denise, because I know we went to undergrad with it. Okay, praise be to Allah.
Actually, I was, I don't want to cut you off.
Go ahead.
Just recalling a memory of you and I at a party. And, you know, before we got on this call, I was thinking of that moment, that interaction that we had. I don't remember what was said. All I remember is I walked away from our interaction with a completely different perspective. And I was like,
Wow.
Yeah. Wow. And I was like, okay, so there's this level of resonance there. Like you know, both of us were preparing for this call, and you're saying like, oh yeah, I'm gonna take 15 minutes to meditate. It's like, oh, I'm gonna take 15 minutes to pray. Oh, same frequency, same wave. So yeah, I was just thinking about that. I don't want to throw you off. Like I said,
all praise belongs to Allah, and that's all praise belongs to Allah. So in that, we have to see that, okay, so, and I don't have my restrictive law of Islam on me right now, but don't gossip.
Yes.
One of the restrictive laws is not to gossip, because it's not just the words that are coming, because I can say I love you, and if my spirit is foul in that, and it's coming from a negative spirit, you can
feel that. Like, that ain't,
but the word I love you came out of my mouth. But if the spirit, so what's the spirit of somebody who's engaging in gossip, talking about another human being that's not there to defend themselves? What are you entertaining that low level of dialogue for to begin with, and what does that do to your thinking? If thought is also something that has motion to it, it moves.
Yes.
But then the thought, so we got blood. Well, we're 70% water. So it takes 8 minutes and 20 seconds for a complete rotation of the blood from top to bottom, from head to toe. So if you're having this conversation for that long, what are you sending through your body?
Yeah.
Right? So
being susceptible to.
Being susceptible to fornication. Fornication is out in a restrictive law, because nature is real. I got to be careful as a single brother. I have to be very careful about my interactions with women. And I've seen it enough to know, it really has to be kept at bay, because one, I can't help but, after so much time and dialogue is spent, you're going to naturally just, we're made to incline towards each other.
Yeah.
So sex happens. And I'm not really trying to commit. It's because of the nature and pleasure was had. But then now I have, what have I done? And I'm going to take most of the responsibility because of where I stand. But what have I done now to a woman, opening her up where she trusts me enough to receive me in her? But I'm not going to be responsible with that and leave her just to in her space.
Right. Yeah.
So now if I don't have to worry about that, it's another restrictive law. Don't feel and pat on sisters. Don't be touching and because the senses, the sensories, nerve, all that stuff. So when you keep yourself away from these activities, it really frees you, because you're operating in a realm where you're in this protective circle. So certain things can't even touch you. You create an atmosphere around yourself.
Space. Very. Wow. I love it.
So that's the area of restrictive.
Yeah.
And you know, at least you had the boldness and the courage to ask for clarity, because some people would just take that in.
Like, I'm not messing with that.
And
I don't like that. I don't like what he said. Oh, no.
You want to be?
Yes. Asking questions, because I do a lot of things. Like, I really like talking about that sacred space, my home. I don't have a lot of company over in my home, you know. That goes back to, you know, keeping your space clear and free, and just protected in a way, because like you said, a woman opening herself up to a man with who has intentions of not really being there for that woman, it's like, it causes damage. You know, there's a buildup of toxins. But it's just really interesting to see the similarities, such close similarities between the Nation of Islam and the teachings of Elijah Muhammad, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and what I do. Like, I absolutely love tarot cards and like oracle cards and stuff like that. So when you say, oh, the teachings are based upon mathematic, work, it's like, oh, okay, so are these tarot cards. Like if I show you the Egyptian tarot, I would change this to Kamishan, but the Egyptian tarot, all cards are numbered, you know, they're numbered, and each number means something, and you know, these cards are they call them archetypes of the human experience, like the cycles and the phases in which we go through as mm-hmm. beings. And absolutely love to do tarot readings. I'm gonna actually get more into them, but my sister introduced me to them, and looking at these cards and the type of feeling and energy and what is elicit, like the feeling that is elicited when you see something visual. Because I always see like men as being very strong in the sense of like just taking the structured way of doing things, and women, the divine feminine, is like, oh, I just want to be creative and, you know, just create some art and put some pictures on a card with a number. And like, oh, I want to be able to tell people something, like give them a message in a way mm-hmm. that, you know, they can take that message empowering them to be able to see things in their own life that they weren't able to see. Like mm-hmm. you said, talking to your brothers and your sisters and stuff like that, you know, it's like they're able to see things in you that you can't see in yourself, and vice versa. So I just wanted to connect those two things. The similarities are striking. I really do see that in the future a lot more of us will be open to having these types of interactions, and the dialogue that we'll share, the knowledge that we'll share, you know, it's all leading us to just a higher state of being.
Unity.
Unity. Yeah.
Unity.
Unity.
I know that you have much to offer.
Yeah.
Being a nutritional psychologist.
Yes, I should.
Spiritual healer, right? You have something to offer to the work of one establishing the kingdom, yeah, or facilitating mm-hmm. the paradigm shift, mm-hmm. or civilizing, helping to civilize your brothers and sisters.
Yes,
right. And as a residual of that humanity, and I know that people, our brothers and sisters in a church, I came out of the church.
Yeah.
And I went back to one of the churches that I grew up in. Now I would call my home church, because the one that I I think about it's nothing is a coincidence.
Right.
The church that I came up in was called Solid Rock, where my fundamental years of development and you know, getting the word, the YPWW, the choir director. Ooh. All of that. Yeah, I directed the choir.
Nice. Are you vocal? Yeah. Coach? Are you a vocal coach?
I'm working on these. Okay, I'm working on it.
Okay.
Because I hadn't taken it seriously up until recently.
Nice. So, but can you feel like, you know, tell somebody, because I'm looking for a vocal coach. So.
I would tell you this. Mm-hmm. Practice on your breathing.
Yes.
And go on YouTube and look up vocal coaches. Absolutely. Because, yeah, because it's really about being comfortable with your own sound.
Yes. Okay.
Like you practice, you know, if you go online and you listen for, you know, notes and things like that, and just work on hitting those notes and in your range.
Uh-huh.
Right. And then you'll gradually get better. But it's about finding your own voice. Don't try to sing like nobody else.
Okay. Yeah.
I stop trying to sing like other people, and then it's like, okay, this is my sound, yeah. And then it gets better.
Okay. Thank you.
But I went back to the church, man, and I was just so before COVID, I was like, damn, like my heart was like open because regardless, this is my foundation. Mm-hmm. Like I can't erase this.
No.
And that love is there, but do my people in the church have the understanding of who it is that they're worshiping or think that they're worshiping?
Mm-hmm.
And are you doing the right thing by worshiping?
Right.
Or should you be striving to follow the example?
Yes. Mm. Mm.
So if there is misunderstanding and I've been blessed with understanding, then I have a responsibility. And so, man, I want to see Christians and Muslims, my spiritual yogis, and I ain't coming off of point number 12. Mm-hmm. And we not coming off of point number 12 in a nation.
Right.
It's like, that might be one of the reasons why some people may be turned off to us, because you'll find with Muslims, like, we not finna buck.
Mm-mm.
I'm not bucking.
Strong. Very,
so,
very strong.
So if you got a problem with me saying, like, I know who God is, like, the supreme being of the universe.
Yes.
That's something for you to reconcile. They ain't got nothing to do. I have a responsibility with that.
Yeah.
But we got to work together, regardless,
yeah,
to get our people out the condition that we in as Black people in this country.
Absolutely.
So you going to trip up over that?
Hey, the littlest things. We look at the bigger picture.
Say that again.
Yeah, looking at the bigger picture, not the picking apart the finest details. Oh, you doing that? Oh, you said restrictive. Oh, you do tarot cards? Oh.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I ain't go flex like I don't have some angel cards at home.
Yeah. Oracle cards. All of them.
Yeah, man. And I got them in my walk outside of, you know, before I came into Islam. Like I said, Emerald Tablets of Thoth, Sacred Geometry.
Yeah.
Like I read that book 19 times.
I actually listened to the audiobook on YouTube.
No, you got it. I'm not. Now I'm finna touch you. You have to read it at least 100 times. What it said before you.
Actually, just falling asleep to it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, our brains are like a recorder.
Uh-huh. But yeah, conscious attention, focus, and concentration is what's needed if you want to hold it in your conscious mind to be able to pull it up.
That is absolutely true. Because it's like, I'll be referring to some stuff and be like, I don't really know that where that came from, but it's here.
Yeah.
So, yeah, this is beautiful. I know we've been talking. We probably talked for like...
I know, we've been talking for an hour. No, 2 hours, because we started at 12. So... Yeah. Any closing words on your end?
I would just...
And then we can debrief after this for about 10 minutes.
Yes, absolutely. So closing words for me, I would just say for anyone who's watching, first of all, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. You are acknowledged and appreciated and loved. And I hope that, you know, you all got something from this to take what resonates and leave the rest behind. Always strive to be the best, you know, your best self, your highest self, and keep an open mind. That's what this is all of this is about is, you know, just connecting with other people who you see is you. Like you are a reflection of me, but I am a reflection of you, but we still have some differences. But in just keeping an open mind and reaching out to people and saying like, hey, I think this, what do you think that? So gaining clarity through dialogue and conversation. And also I have a holistic health group that I host on the WhatsApp. It's called Sunday Fun Day. We meet every Sunday for about 30 to 45 minutes and on Zoom. And throughout the week, I've just, you know, drop little tidbits and gold nuggets of holistic health tips and tricks and recipes, alkaline recipes, and we exercise together. I make sure everyone is being held accountable and doing the things that, you know, will propel us to being our highest self. So check out my website, divinefitnessblog.com. It's newly updated. We'll be posting blogs as well. And I can't wait to check out your blogs. Let us know where we can find you and connect with you and just read more. Like just that. Yeah, we want more.
Voila. Okay, yeah. First things first with my physical blog, with my writing. It's at freekidbeans, that like blog post. It's on a Google blog.
Okay.
I'll send that to you. So I'll send you a link to that so you can have it and you know, inshallah, share it, read it.
Yes.
Comment, share. Okay.
Yes.
As far as videos go, social media, Free Kid Beans, that's the FreeKidD.
Okay.
BEANS, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, SoundCloud. That's where I'm on all of those. So I do music as well. So it's a complete experience with your brother. Like I said, God, art, psychology.
Yes, beautiful.
Videos, I'll be doing more videos as I begin to create more content. I'm getting into a space where I'm getting back to my creativity. So, you know, be looking out for that. And I would like to leave you guys with two quotes.
Okay.
The basis of the teachings of Master Far Muhammad, Tulianu Elijah Muhammad, was six words: accept your own and be yourself.
Yes.
I'll say it again. Accept your own and be yourself.
Ashe.
Ain't nothing more liberated than that.
Yes.
You know, so you can play with that and what it means and meditate on it. And the more you concentrate, the more it'll hit. And this is the last piece. Okay. This was from a lecture September 2nd, 1990 from the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Mm-hmm. The title of the lecture is The Great Power and Value of the Black Woman.
Yes.
It says, how you use God's spirit determines who you are.
Yes.
If you use God's energy and spirit to do God's will, you are the people of God. If you use God's energy to oppose God, you are the devil.
The adversary.
Ain't that black and white? Do good, you with God. Do wrong,
lower the other side. Lower vibration. Absolutely. It's beautiful. Well, thank you. Thank you. Thank you so very much, Brother Darren X, for, you know, reaching out and sharing your wealth of knowledge. Absolutely. I appreciate you. I love you. Thank you. And I just want to remind everyone that true wealth is true health. So seek truth and love yourself. Until next time, peace, love, and light.
Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum. All right. Oop. All right, I'm going to have to edit this part out. All right, let me stop it.